But no.
We had this big fleshy thing.
But no, because like, yeah, no, I had, well, I'll show you what I had. I mean, it's not.
Oh, we're going to see it.
To start with this, in honor of the spectacular series here on Sam Amazing Shit, fuck you, Chris. We are doing our yearly allotted 4 horror films because I am not super into horror movies, you know. And last week we had Halloween, and everyone should be excited about Halloween. Uh-huh. This should be the highest grossing movie of October. Fuck Venom. I really hope people go and see Halloween because it's a good, great movie.
I think it's going to do really well.
I really hope so. And I saw it thinking, please beat Venom, please beat Venom, please beat Venom, because you're so much better and you deserve it more. But that's coming from someone who's not really into the horror genre like some people, you know? So I worry if I'm not the right person to talk about horror because I'm more aligned to more, you know, popcorny movies and action movies and thrillers and other things like that that aren't real necessarily horror.
There's a lot of shit in the horror genre. You know, for every good film, there's like 10 bad ones. So I can understand why you would feel that way.
Right. And now this week is a completely different monster. Yes. No pun intended, where we have The Fly, which is definitely a horror movie, but as I mentioned earlier, not in the slasher way or the undead type of way. This is the Cronenbergian body horror. This is just creepy things happening to the flesh and not necessarily violence, but just mutation and all sorts of disgusting things with it.
Destruction of the body.
Right. And because here we have Seth Brundle?
Seth Brundle.
Jeff Goldblum, which I'll probably just keep calling him Jeff Goldblum.
Let's just call him Goldblum.
It's easier that way. But he's at a scientific conference talking about he's going to change the world. Mm-hmm. Had this world-changing invention. He's talking this to Gina Davis, who's not impressed. She's just like, I'm a reporter. I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Everybody says they're going to change the world. I don't really believe you. Because honestly, when you hear him and you look at him, you see his fuzzy feathered hair. You see his weird
Jerry
bug
curl,
eyes.
You mean his Jerry curl?
Oh, his sweet Jerry curl. When you see all that stuff, it's not really convincing that he has anything worth selling.
What am I working on? I'm working on something that'll change the world and human life as we know it.
What happened?
You got it all right. You just can't handle it. Your stocking has just been teleported from one pod to another. Absolutely not. In fact, I'm going to have to ask you for that tape, please.
You can't do that.
Don't you dare write a story. I'd never have told any of this stuff to a journalist.
But you did tell this stuff to a journalist.
Well, yeah, in a way, I suppose I did. That
sure did.
Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute.
And you kind of feel for the guy.
Oh, totally.
Because he's just a lonely scientist man.
The movie makes a great choice in just making him instantly likable from the offset. Awkward, but that's Jeff Goldblum.
Right, awkward.
You know, eccentric, but also humorous. Charming. And I'm just like, thank you for doing that.
Right. I mean, because like he's really smart, but he's socially dumb. You know, he's
just
kind of, he doesn't kind of get it. When I saw it, when he described himself, I was like, yeah, this is kind of like a Steve Jobs type of guy where he's not making the technology.
He's not an asshole, though.
He's not an asshole, but he's not making the technology. He's not the most brilliant guy in the room.
Yes.
But he's the orchestrator of that where he's like, I'm going to take bits and pieces from here. I'm going to redesign this. I'm going to frame it like this. Yeah. And this is going to be something new that everyone's going to use.
And that plays into it. Actually, it's like, yeah, I mean, I'm not the smartest guy. He's like, well, that's what led to the situation.
Right. You know, but he's more of the producer, and it takes like a level of solitude to figure that kind of stuff out. Mm-hmm. And so that's why he's in this warehouse by himself working on all these on this science project, because no one else gets it. You know, he's just like a kind of a loner in his own way. And so he's discovered teleportation.
Amazing.
Fucking teleportation. Like, just that alone as the concept is very funny to me, because the 50s one was a teleporter, essentially. Mm-hmm. This is a teleporter, and we still don't have that technology. We can probably remake this movie again with the same thing, where it's like, yeah, we want to invent teleportation. You know, greenhouse gases, global warming's happening. Mm-hmm. We should probably develop this. But he doesn't want the word out. So Gina Davis is like, you know what? Fuck that. I'm going to run this story because you invented fucking teleportation. Mm-hmm. And her editor's like, you're dumb. This isn't real. This is a magic trick.
It's Borens.
Chief editor Stathis Borens.
What a name.
That's not even a name. I thought that was a guy from Game of Thrones.
It sounds like a waspy kind of like name.
It's just not a real name.
It's not.
Stathis Borens.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to say people have been comparing me to him. Do I kind of look like him?
Who has been comparing you to him?
like some of my friends.
Those are not your friends. Okay, hold on. Let's go ahead and do that real quick. Dare to, okay. Oh, you know what? You need a little more face.
I need a little more hair. Other than that, though,
You're a bearded white guy. And so they start spending a little bit of time together, and they go through some experiments to figure out if they can get this shit to work.
The world will want to know what you're thinking.
Fuck is what I'm thinking.
You're very cute. You know that?
Am I? Oh,
what happened?
Oh, my back. Ow.
Oh.
Jesus.
Oh. You want to try an experiment?
Sure.
And so, I'm going to beat this meat right now.
That's how it gets off.
He has to beat the meat. But getting it off, though, the weird thing is that how does a baboon turning inside out turn Gina Davis on? Because she's like, this baboon got turned inside out.
There's a lot of kinky shit in this movie.
This is the most gruesome thing I've ever seen. Hey, you're kind of cute. You know that, right? Cuter than that baboon carcass that's inside there. But it's like, they get all smoochy face.
Yeah, they do.
And it's like, ugh. That for me was the only jarring thing where it was like, okay, they're spending time together. Yeah. They're trying to get this stuff to work. But then all of a sudden she's just like, ooh, you look sexy. And it's like, I don't get why, but sure. He's a handsome enough man.
I buy it because they have just instantaneous chemistry with each other. And later on, I mean, after this movie, Gina Davis and Goldblum actually dated for a long time, for years even. And I think, again, that's what's the most effective about this film is their relationship in terms of the character stuff. But yeah, when they just start fucking, I'm just like, this is hot.
What?
Yeah, I was just like, I'm sorry, man. It gets even better as the film goes on. I was like, I'm into this.
Yeah, really?
Yeah, I'm just like, I buy it. I was just like, it just feels natural, man.
I guess. I didn't really think that way about the sex. It was just like basic 80s movie, like under the covers. Like, yeah, we saw him come.
Oh,
right,
but later
that
on,
was a little
but
weird.
Later on, this is like he's just thrusting. They're sweating. I like they showed the sweat. I'm like, see, that's authentic.
That's authentic Goldblum sweat.
Some good makeup work there.
But, that's some craft moistness crafted on his face. But here's the thing, though. Over time, though, we talk about the meat. But over time, they're trying to get the meat down. Not just the fucking, but the meat of transferring different kind of products and skin and muscle tissue and things like that. And they start having meals together. They start eating fake steaks like they're about to do right here. They're trying to get this whole thing to work, and slowly and surely it does. And they're spending all this time together getting more and more lovely, and it's a wonderful thing that you see building in this first act of this movie. These people are falling in love over science. It's a beautiful thing. It's the wet dream of any nerdy kid who wants to invent things. He's just like, oh, I want a beautiful journalist to find me hot and do things to me. And that's all cool. Actually, that's really cool because it's like, you know, it's very sweet and it's very nice and it's very positive for them to start a horror movie, at least what you think is a horror movie, just like that. Very, very sweetly, very calmly, and very romantic.
It makes you like the characters, which you don't often get in a lot of horror films.
Right. You know, sometimes you just don't care if they live or die.
Exactly.
Like, you're just whatever. But these people are really cool. But with all the progress they make in the science realm.
Yes.
The machine actually finally works, and their relationship is in full swing, and we see that, like, hey, maybe this whole thing is going to work out, because you're watching this movie, and you're not getting any indication that things are going to go wrong.
Mm-hmm.
There's some personal conflict, interpersonal conflict, but nothing out of the ordinary of someone's everyday life.
Exactly.
And then you realize that the movie is called The Fly, and that has to play an important role, but... Mm-hmm. While you're not paying attention to the name during the movie, you're like, this is really fun.
Yes.
I am enjoying this. They're really doing it. But then the movie had to happen, and something comes when that happens.
I think it's time for champagne.
Oh, no.
What? What's that?
By the way, that's going to be my Christmas present to you later this year.
Picture.
It's just a poster
I'll put up in
of
my room.
Jeff Goldblum staring intently in a graphic form.
I just want up on my ceiling at that point.
Oh, with a mirror in front of you. That's going to be great. Mm-hmm. A lot of sexiness going on here.
Nothing. It's just personal bullshit. Look, I have to go out for a few hours.
No, Ronnie. Spicy eggplant, champagne.
Just for a few hours.
Residue means her old boyfriend, doesn't it? Stathis Barnes is her old boyfriend. What are we waiting for? Let's do it. It's too bad Ronnie missed it.
Oh, fuzzy baboon.
All worked out.
It, it all worked out. It's Everything's fine. Looks good. And what I like about this scene, though, in particular, is that this is not a mad scientist.
Nope.
He's not some raving lunatic who's like, I'm going to take over the world. I'm going to be the greatest who ever lived. He's just like, you know what? I understand that this is an important invention, but I need this to work with people for it to be worth anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's already worth a lot.
It'd be $1 billion, $1 trillion.
He wants to change the world. He's beyond just industry, right? But at this moment, he's not some mad scientist. He's just a guy who's jealous of an ex-boyfriend.
He's a guy that just made a mistake because he drank too much alcohol. It feels like, oh, we've all been in that situation where we got mad. We had a few drinks. And we're like, oh, God, you're upset.
Yeah.
And that's what he does. It's just like, oh, no, it's such a mistake. It feels natural.
Now, I am not a trigger warning guy. I am not that guy.
Okay.
I'm not that guy. Uh-huh. But I seldom do that on these shows. You know, I usually do it for like assaults and stuff like that, like sexual assault and things like that. Meet the Feebles. That was the one
one needed it.
Well, I was like, if you're not expecting this, there's some gross shit going on. And when there's just things that are just gross or unsavory, not like violent necessarily, like fucking Temple of Doom, we understand.
That's fine.
It's comic.
That's
you know,
like B.
Comic violence and stuff like that. Violence. But here, it's Cronenberg. And, you know, I kind of have to do that here. Because not for necessarily you guys. You guys may be able to handle it.
Stomach it, maybe.
Pretty well. Yeah. You could stomach it well, but I couldn't. Yeah, I was having a hard time with some of these scenes right here because it just messed with me, man. These special effects, this decrepit kind of transition that he eventually comes on and goes on, it messed with me a lot. And I was like watching this movie like really anxious half the time. Oh, so to compliment the mood changes, Brundle goes out and he's like,
oh, I love this scene.
You know what? Yeah. You don't want to fuck me? Fine. I'm going to go fuck somebody else. Yes. I'm going to go out and get me some poontang. And you know what? It adds to that fucking fly-style machismo that goes down at this bar. Like I said, brace yourself.
I got $100 says I can beat either one.
No. I did it. Well, he just puts his hand up like, look at what I've done.
Yeah.
Kalima. And Jason winced over there. You got him to flinch.
Yeah, you
got him, to flinch. And now that's what I'm waiting for because he's never seen this movie. Ray Romano's not seen this movie.
Yeah. Well,
and so I'm like going to be playing these next couple scenes thinking like that. But like, I knew that scene was in this movie.
Yeah.
I had seen it before on YouTube and I was like, oh, that's pretty gross. But then I forgot. Like, it just emptied my mind and it was like, oh, this is this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's horrible in the context in which it happens
sure.
because not only is it just like a disgusting effect, but then you have like this white cream sweat that he's got
like
going
the,
on his fingers.
The androids from Alien leaking milk or something.
Right. And that's the thing. It was like, oh, this is his like fly super sticky strength or whatever. So he's able to hold on tighter.
Mm-hmm.
And then as we will see in the Sammy Ainsley shit, Sammy Gonzalez frame by frame replay, let's go ahead and take a look. You got the effect already ready, and it's not a real hand, but when you get that tearing of the flesh, you get that whole gaping, and you got the flesh underneath it. When that goes live, that is a painful thing, and then he lifts his hand, and then you just have that effect right there.
Just sticking
it's
out
like
a
broken, I don't know what that bone is.
The arm bone,
not your femur, that's your leg.
The thing is, there's something like almost worse than the fact that someone pulled your arm so much it just snaps. Like you fall down, you break your arm, it's like, okay, that's bad. But the idea is someone put so much pressure that the bone goes through the skin. Ugh.
Well, that happens in arm wrestling contests sometimes.
Oh, God.
Like the guys who are professional arm wrestlers, that'll happen where they'll just break and then it'll let loose and they'll recognize there's no resistance, so they'll let go. But it never breaks through the skin like that.
Mm-hmm.
So to
that's
see it like tear
it
open is fucking disgusting. And that one is usually, or that's actually one of the things I'll say about this movie, though, is that everyone has their one thing from this movie that grosses them out the most.
Right.
So like for some people, that's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Watching an arm tear off of somebody's arm, that's the one thing that shakes them up more than any of the other things that happen in this movie. And that for me was pretty bad because it's caught me off guard because I forgot. But broken bones are broken bones. I've played football. I never broke a bone, but I've seen, you know, guys have a cast, and I kind of have a concept of sports science and not sports,
sports
science,
injuries,
sports and injuries, like and things like that. Mm-hmm. Someone tears their ACL or whatever. I know what that is, and it hurts, and it looks bad. I can deal with that.
Right.
That's pretty tolerable. I've seen those things. However, this next scene is the number one gross out moment for me in this movie.
All right.
Because each of these scenes are highlighted by a very poignant and emotional scene, either before or after, where you're not just getting the scene where, oh, his arm rips off, nothing happens of that. No. Things happen in relation to the story that follow that and precede that. He got into an argument. He went out to fuck somebody, broke a guy's arm, went back home to fuck her.
Right.
That's a whole part of the scene that is the why they have that broken arm.
It's a good lead up to all these.
It's a good lead up. That's the right way to put it.
Yeah.
That's why you have that scene.
Yes.
To shock and then to move on with the plot.
Yeah.
For here, right after that, where he's having sex with the girl and having the sweaty sex that you like so very, very much, Ronnie comes back to check on him, telling him that she got some results back from the hair clippings that she took in, because she was like, what are these weird hair clippings that you have on your back? And his freak out just emphasizes what happens to him next.
You're changing, Seth. Everything about you is changing. Those weird hairs that were growing out of your back, I took them to a lab. I had them analyzed. In fact, very likely insect hairs. You've got to get some help. I think you must be sick.
You're jealous!
That part is just, weird. Like, it's just weird. Like, you're jealous! Like, what kind of crazy person just leans into somebody? He just leans into somebody with their eyes.
Yeah.
I'm going to intimidate you with my eyes. Fuck you, Jeff Goldblum.
I've become free. I've been released, and you can't stand it.
It's pretty bad. Yeah. Oh, that's the one that does it right there.
No!
Yeah, peel that baby off.
Is this how it starts? Am I dying?
So it's the nail scene. That's what gets
No, 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 okay. no. Oh, Mamma Mia, Mamma Mia. No! We're not doing that. We are not here for that.
What makes that scene so great is then the juice that's still coming out of his fingers, though.
That's the thing.
And then it's his realization that's like, am I dying? Uh-oh.
This is the third time of me watching that. Accidentally the fourth when they showed a little bit in the trailer. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you saw me during the trailer, but I winced and I turned away.
I was like, man.
No! We're not doing this because I can do the pus. Honestly, that part wasn't the part that got me. Oh, God, I'm looking at it again. Like, so, like, that part where it's just... a pimple bursts, right. Okay?
We've all had that.
I
maybe not that.
But. I'm not like those guys. Like, I kind of not... Like, I don't look for popping videos. Like, you know, people will pop the pimples.
You people are fucking freaks. Stop watching that.
Like somebody, like, but I'll happen upon one, and I'll be like... That's kind of interesting, but I'll watch like 30 seconds and I'll be done because I don't need to see like 30 minutes of it. It's just like, okay, that's cool. Like a big pimple, right? But then there's people that just love that shit and it's just gross.
I don't get it.
But for me, nail damage just fucking ruins me.
Yeah.
It just ruins me because I've played football and I've had toes stepped on. I've had fingers, you know, not broken, but jammed and stuff like that. And that's fine. But as a kid... And even actually recently, I've had my toes crushed because I got big feet.
Yeah.
So like one time it got crushed, it turns purple and then it heals and then the nail falls off and then you have to wait for it to grow back.
Yep.
In Chicago, when we were at the Chicago show, when I was doing the line work and I was talking to people and doing stuff, there was a tree with bricks around it that were lifted up by the branches and I stubbed my toe on it really hard. It killed not my big toe, but the tall toe next to it.
Right.
And my nail fell off like a month later.
Because
I bruised it and it shattered. Mm-hmm. So I've had to deal with this for like the last couple months since the Chicago show. July. It's barely almost all the way healed back up.
Oh, that's good. Yeah.
Which is good.
Yeah.
But no.
We had this big fleshy thing.
But no, because like, I had, I'll show you what I had. Yeah. I mean, it's not.
We're going to see it?
It's that part. Where it's just like, it just is empty skin. And it's just
so squishy too. Is it super squishy and stuff like
you touch? It's just sensitive. It's just it's like it's like a it's like oh god, I keep
Did it erupt? Did you leak milk?
I leaked. Yes, I leaked milk. No, this shit is grossing me out. I'm looking at it right now, yeah. And Sami Zayn's frame by frame, like,
oh, that's good slow mo on that.
You can do that, or just, he just rips it off, and it just,
that's a great effect.
It looks real. And yeah, that like the way that, because there is like a little bit of goo underneath it, because it's the adhesive that keeps your nail down. Mm-hmm. It's gross. Oh, it's gross. Fuck, it's gross. And it ruined me. Sure. I was like cringing.
Yeah.
Just my body was like this.
That's,
and my
body
hands
horror, man.
Were like this. That's, and my toes were curled. And then I thought of that scene in Daredevil where, what's his name? Snake? No, his hand,
The stick.
Stick. Steak, where they put the bamboo
shoots under his
fingers, and I heard about that in Vietnam where they did that for real.
So John McCain went.
And John McCain did that shit, and I'm like, no, I can't, I fucking can't. And it's,
well, I wonder if you have the scene in there that freaked me out the most in this movie.
What happened?
Do you have the scene?
I have all of them.
Okay, so we'll
fuck
get to
that
it.
Shit. Yeah, we'll get to them. In the chat, Sammy, ouch. Yeah. Oh my god!
On the right side, no.
Ouch! I didn't notice him hitting the tree. Yeah, I tripped over the side. Yeah, my shoe was on, and I was like, "Hey, everybody!" Boom! Yeah. And I tripped, and I was like, caught myself, and I was like, "Oh, that hurt." I might have broke. I didn't break my toe because I was still able to walk on it, but it hurt a lot, and it was purple. It was purple that whole time, and it was purple time after that. But yeah,
I'm sorry.
That hurts a lot, and I can't do nail violence. I can't do that.
That's pretty. No, it's graphic.
It's fucking gross. It's about that time.
YouTube comments?
No, it's not. No, it's not YouTube comments time. Sorry, YouTube comments time. This is part two.
Oh, is that what
of our top 10, top 100 Sammy 80 shit 100 episodes, top scores of forever.
You expect me to remember that? That whole description? That title of that thing?
Yes! Right. So, everybody, welcome to the Sammy 18 Shit Top 100 special bonus feature. Go ahead and hit the like button, hit it again, hit it a third time. It's a triple like. You're not exempt. Triple like. Go ahead and do it. I think that's a bad word in England. But go ahead and triple like. Go ahead and comment down below. We'll be reading your stuff next week, going back to normal. Mm. And be sure to subscribe to Double Toast. And be sure to go to dtmerch.com. That's dtmerch.com. Buy some stuff. There's new stuff. And it's gone. So, no more YouTube comments time for now. Mm-hmm. But we're going to go over the top 100. We'll do it very quickly, but we want to reveal the final list.
All right. Yeah.
So, we'll start with you because you only had 20 movies. And people were pissed.
Yeah, I was like, you guys knew referenced it by saying.
Oh, no, it froze.
Oh, no.
There you are.
We preferenced it by saying that I've only seen 20 of these films. Even my bottom 10, I like a lot of these movies.
Right.
It's just like, all right.
So someone got mad. It's like, you put Halloween in the bottom 10? Fuck you. Yeah, of 20 movies, well, let's go ahead and take a revisit. I didn't recolor it.
Yeah.
But keep in mind that the blues are rentals.
Mm-hmm.
Spider-Man 3.
Yeah, awful film. I hate that movie.
Deep Blue Sea, Mission Impossible, Alien vs. Predator as rentals.
Rentals, yep.
Matinees, Meet the Feebles, End of Seas, Henry Strength the Kids, Sister Act, Temple of Doom. Number 11, Halloween.
Mm-hmm. Which I gave a high matinee.
You gave a high matinee. It's the best matinee you have.
Yeah.
But here we are to full prices in gold and better than sex is in red. You have four better than sex is 20 episodes.
I like my sex.
And then the rest of them are full prices. So you know what? Let's go ahead and take a reveal.
Okay.
For Chris's top 10 so far. Number 10, we have Ocean's 11's bitch ass.
Solid movie.
Number 9, Inglourious Basterds. Number 8, The Land Before Time. Number 7, The Evil Dead. Number 6, Blues Brothers. Number 5, Training Day. And Denzel looking pissed that you didn't put him higher. Number 4, Tombstone at Better Than Sex Going Forward. Number 3, The Incredibles. Number 2, Jurassic Park. And the number 1 movie that you've seen so far in your top 20, Big Trouble in Little China.
Big Trouble.
Why Big Trouble?
Because it's that movie I can just go back to. It's like, it's in my top 10 favorite films of all time. I just think it's ahead of its time. It's a critique on action films. You have great comedy. I mean, Kurt Russell's giving the performances of his life. It's a kung fu movie that, you know, isn't all about the fighting. It's about the personalities and the friendships. And you got an over-the-top villain, man. It just holds up to the stage. It's a movie I can put on any time and just watch and like, yeah, this is just a great presentation.
So there you go. And I don't think a lot of people will disagree with your top five. I mean, that's for all the ones we've watched so far.
That's the order I put them
so
in, too.
So those are really good. Mm-hmm. Now, go ahead, and if you have seen all 20 episodes that Chris has been on, they've all been on YouTube.
Yeah.
So you can go ahead and watch all those episodes. Go ahead and take a look at all those. If you agree with those episodes, go right ahead and check them out. Let us know if you agree with Chris's list. Now, since Ian is not here, I was going to do the rest of his list, but I'll do that later.
All right.
But I will do his top 10, just so we can give him his due diligence, because he has seen 80 episodes with us. So even though he's not here, let's go ahead and take a look at his top 10. So Ian's top 10 is as follows. Number 10, all better than Sexes, by the way.
Okay.
Number 10, Die Hard. Number 9, Dawn of the Dead, 1978. Number 8, Halloween. Number 7, Blade Runner. Number 6, Aliens. Number 5, The Thing. Number 4, Superman 78. Number 3, The Road Warrior. Number 2, Children of Men. And at number 1, Raiders of the Lost Ark. What do you think of that list?
I mean, number 1, I agree with that. Raiders is also one of my favorite films of all time. That's certainly in my top 10. I'm the kind of the guy that Children of Men, I like Children of Men a lot. But I don't know, the Greek people just praise that film. It's kind of ridiculous
to me.
What?
You think so?
I think it moves a little too slow. I think there's some great cinematography work, and I mean, the camera work is amazing. Like that whole shot where they just don't break and everything.
Oh, yeah.
That's cool. But I don't know, the story, I was like, yeah, this is fine. I guess I couldn't get attached to any of the characters.
And you didn't agree with Halloween being so high.
No, I think that movie has a lot of flaws.
Fucking sucks. You think it's bullshit? Fuck Halloween.
I appreciate Halloween. It's just that I just think that the movie is probably too slow and it's dated to a number of ways.
But you know what? I think a lot of people who are out there would agree with that list.
Yeah, that's good. No, it's a good list of films.
Let's see what the chat says. Actually, someone says Ian's top 10 is almost perfect. Good job, man. There's Ian's list, so go ahead and let us know what you think of Ian's list. Somebody said it was perfect, so you know what? It's a pretty solid list. I will have to say, there's nothing really of the 100 episodes, or 80 episodes he did, that you can really disagree with. Nothing seems too out of place. Now, my tastes are a little different than everybody else's, but without further ado, the Sammy Ain't Seen Shit top 100, top 10. Let's go ahead and take a look. Number 10, The Iron Giant.
Yeah.
Number 9, Raiders of the Lost Ark. Number 8, Tombstone. Number 7, Akira. Number 6, The Original Mad Max. Number 5, The Blues Brothers. Number 4, Jurassic Park. Number 3, Terminator 2. Number 2, Blazing Saddles. And number 1, fuck you.
Okay. Hey,
Children of Men.
I didn't say I hate that film. I just think
I'm a fucking idiot for liking it.
No, I gave it like a low full price.
Your thoughts. Oh my god, that is a masterpiece. Let's go ahead and take a look. Iron Giant is the epitome of a great children's film, children's media, great animation, good mixture, good story, peril, all good things you want in a children's story. Raiders of the Lost Ark, best fun, comic-y, pulpy adventure film.
Quintessential adventure movie.
I have some problems with it, but not enough to keep it out of my top 10. Mm-hmm. Number 8, Tombstone. You want to know how I was raised on movies, Tombstone is a definitive movie of how I grew up.
Sure.
It doesn't need to be the best. Doesn't need to be the flashiest. Mm-hmm. It doesn't need to have the best dialogue. It just so happens to have it. Just give me fun, and I will love it. And I love that movie. And like people say, that is one of the most rewatchable movies you could ever watch.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Number 7, Akira. Yeah. Gross me out. Freak me out.
Oh, boy, yeah.
Get me wondering what the fuck I'm watching. Mm-hmm. If you get, like I told you this week, if you get a visceral reaction out of me, you will be remembered. And I remember Akira. That shit fucked me up. Sure. And I absolutely love it. Here's the one that people are going to get mad about. Number 6, Mad Max the Original. So here's the thing.
All right.
I watched Mad Max first. I had not seen The Road Warrior or Thunderdome.
Thunderdome or
Fury Road. I saw Fury Road.
Okay.
So that was my only reference point. Even then, that's so removed that it's really not influential of the other ones.
Not the trilogy, yeah.
So what I liked about Mad Max the Original, is my definitive version of what you can do with a low budget.
Sure.
And what I absolutely love about it the most is, one, that everything was fucking real.
Mm-hmm.
Two, these guys made it in their fucking bathtub or in their kitchen, splicing everything together by hand. Mm-hmm. And three, the sound design is fucking amazing for guys who did nothing. Guys who are just making some shit in their living room, in their kitchen. It's a fucking feat of what you can do. It is like a testament to what filmmaking can be. Having guys hang out of cars, filming people driving into each other, getting all these old cars and just crashing into things. World building, where you have this world that is on the verge of being destroyed completely. It's not fully gone yet. And I fucking love every part of that. So
it's definitely the one that stands out the most from all the Mad Max movies.
Right.
So I can see that.
I fucking loved it. Number 5, The Blues Brothers.
Yep, great comedy.
You want comedy? You want family fun? You want people to cuss and say, shut up, woman. I know what I'm doing. Go watch The Blues Brothers. As we watched that episode, Carrie Fisher's in there. The Blues Brothers are in there.
Dan Aykroyd,
John Belushi. Yep. There's just Aretha Franklin, rest in peace. We have not Carl Weathers. We have so many people in this movie, and it's just such a fun movie. Yep. I had a fucking blast with it. Mm-hmm. Number 4, Jurassic Park, goes without saying.
Classic.
Terminator 2, Ian was there with me. I was cheering watching and doing the review for that movie. I was fucking cheering for it. I love that movie. I need to watch it again. But that movie is just so much fun.
Did you cry?
I didn't cry.
Oh, okay.
But I had so much fucking fun with that movie that I couldn't put it any lower. But then we get to number two with Blazing Saddles. Now, Blazing Saddles, I'm a big fan of Mel Brooks.
Sure, of course.
That was the first time I saw it. That was the first episode we did. Mm-hmm. And it stayed on top over 98 other movies.
Yeah.
That's the crazy. There are 99 other movies. Or 98 other movies, because there's only one above it. Blazing Saddles is fucking funny. You can't do it again. You can't make those jokes again. You can't make it again. You will never get anything like it. It is the most unique thing you will probably watch if you haven't already seen it.
Yeah.
It is that funny.
Well, Mel Brooks is best.
Mel Brooks is best. And number one, Children of Men. Mm-hmm. When you talk about movies that are just well-written, well-paced, visceral, well-acted, great world building, great editing, great camera work, great everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fucking masterpiece. And when I watched it, I was, even all the fucking artsy films and all the bullshit I saw in school didn't mean a goddamn thing until I saw that movie, because I was able to apply and appreciate everything about that movie from that perspective. And I just could not get enough of that movie.
Yeah.
So
yeah, camera work's pretty good.
Fuck you. Let's go to your list where you put fucking your favorite movie without question, without anybody asking.
At this time, at this point.
No, ever. It's just Big Trouble in Little China and Jurassic Park and Training Day. And Ocean's 11's your 10th favorite movie. No other movie. Ocean's 11.
Don't put that out there.
The Land Before Time is his favorite movie, everybody.
Yeah,
number
great,
eight.
Film, Don Bluth.
Just fucking that's it. So you know what? Let us know what you think of our top 100. And fuck it. If you got the time, put your top 100. Put your top 10 of all the movies I've done.
Yeah.
So you saw my list. You can go ahead and put your top 10. Pick your 10 favorites and put that down in the comment section. Let me know what your top 10 of all the 100 movies we've seen. Actually, the 101. Let's throw the fly in there if that's in the top 10.
Why not?
So you know what? Thank you for watching. I do appreciate all 100 episodes. I'm going to put that list, and I'm going to see if I can have time to finish Ian's list and put that on Instagram and Facebook as well. So be sure to look out for that. So with that said, thank you for Top 100 Sam Yancey Shit, Top 100 Thomas Time. And be sure to leave your comments. Be sure to triple like. Be sure to subscribe to Double Toes to get us to a billion and do all that stuff. And always be sure to say bye to the YouTube. Say bye to YouTube.
Bye, YouTube.
Go to the other things. Buy the stuff and everything.